media is Twitter picking up Slack, and is this just the transition zone? Is this like the old days where you between where we used to put, like, you know, anyone that used to work in print, we used to use the little things to put it on paper and scan it and then put it in. So is this just a transitional phase? And what is the future model? So we'll have a quick discussion about that at the very end, because I want us to kind of come to some sort of takeaway that New Zealand Twitter is quite unique. We mostly know each other, we mostly interact with each other, sometimes on a personal basis. Maybe we can have some sort of code of conduct that we do, that we can try and influence. So we're going to start taking questions from the audience, and I see Blue Cap Dude has put his hand up, so it's been mine. Is it somebody to grab the mic and take it from me?
I'm a writers festival in Singapore a couple of years ago. One of the guys said that whilst you saw BBC and CNN going for shorter and shorter clips, he said that he saw Longstream with sort of Al Jazeera as it's making a renaissance. Something in the blogging space I've noticed is a move from saying post every day to post a quality thing that get read and is green, evergreen. So is the long form, is the evergreen sort of the feature piece actually making a comeback, whereas the day-to-day news is a separate thing which has got to get it out quick, whereas the feature piece I think actually is actually thriving.
Okay,
Well,
it's not necessarily blogging, but one thing I like to look at is the BuzzFeed model, and you might groan that they're going to just write about Disney princesses, but BuzzFeed has been doing a lot of long-form journalism, and for quite some time. I particularly like their film journalism, with the likes of Kate Arthur writing about writing about film in long form, and I'm reading that on my phone. It's interesting when you think about it, saying, well, long form is having a resurgence, when you're constantly hearing mobile is the way you're going to keep it short, sharp, and mobile is on a tiny screen. But I do actually tend to agree, and I think that there is a business model in the likes of BuzzFeed, which has no print attachment, it's just web-based, and they are actually doing long-form journalism, and I guess building those brands again, where people decide, actually, I can relate to this person who works for BuzzFeed, and so I'm going to follow their stuff. So, yeah, I just think long-form in that sense has actually had quite a resurgence.
Doesn't the big read, which is that the Herald or help me somebody, is that the Herald or Fairfax? That comes out online, right? Apparently that is a really well-read piece, and you would think that that runs contrary to, you know, to what we're talking about, that everything we read online or everything we click on is a, you know, couple of paragraphs. But I think the big read that comes out on our Sunday, is quite well subscribed to in terms of just eyeballs on it. Am I right?
Yep, so for me, an average blog post would be about, if I'm not taking it from a person that's come out from one of the various contexts that I have, a very standard post is about 500 words long, so a very short essay, but periodically I will go for long form. By long form, that's usually about between 2,000 and 3,000 words. Now that doesn't happen often. It's usually, it will have to be a topic that one, I feel impassioned about, and two, has to be a topic that, that my readers that I've grown to know will also be too passionate about. So the last long form that I did that got up to 3,000 in length, so you're starting to push dissertation level, was it's probably a transport piece. It was on the Manukau bus interchange in transport, do my thoughts about it afterwards. Answering the question though, just quickly about the long form, I say it is saying that I have seen it come through a renaissance, it is coming back, and it's great. Answering a question I just picked up here about us thinking that the average punter, the average viewer think a high value in the new in the news. I'll let that one be open for interpretation because it depends who it is. To me, I group the Twitter New Zealand into three groups. New Zealand Twitter, who I like to, as the avatar I used to know, who goes by the handle Dairyman, and his tweets all about the dairy farm. That's quite great. You have Auckland Twitter, which is unique in itself, which tweets about anything and everything Auckland. And then we have Wellington. Our friends in Wellington, I'll get going in a moment, who, when the term Twitterati was coined by old Paddy Gower, although it's an American term, he was referring to Wellington. My friends in Wellington, we do love you.
We love Wellington Twitter, but they are a bit special.
Just on this business of long form and how some websites overseas are doing more long form, that's a transitional issue around the business model. So someone's mentioned, I see on the stream here, that BuzzFeed shouldn't be put together with journalism in the same word, in the same phrase. And I can see why they'd say that, because BuzzFeed is really the king of clickbait. It's the king of the listicle. But BuzzFeed has an investigations unit with 8 full-time journalists given months to write stories. And just in the last couple of weeks, they broke the tennis match-fixing story. So they combined with the BBC to break the tennis match-fixing story. So BuzzFeed is a really interesting model because they don't sell display advertising. What they do is, and what they've done, is set up essentially an advertising studio attached to the editorial operation, which then goes to advertisers and says, we can write a story that tells your story and put it into the BuzzFeed site. And so people will share that story on Facebook and other places, and you can pay us some money to be on our site, as opposed to buying the normal display advertising. And that forces the BuzzFeed to produce stories that keep people on the site for longer, reading longer down the story, and builds up the BuzzFeed brand so that they can then sell the sponsorship to others. And my understanding of the spin-off in New Zealand is that it's looking to use a similar model. So this is about the death of display advertising and the shift to the sponsored marketing model for supporting the system.
Okay,
so
it's
having
a bit of fun.
It's a bit mesmerising, isn't it?
Just picked up a question down below that's just about to scroll off the page from Matthew, and it's a question I'm going to ask everyone in here, as well as Twitter that are watching in general. Is mass media declining, and as a result, the rise of niche, whether it's journalism or social media and blogging, taking its place? For example, in Auckland, myself, transport blog, or public address. So again, is mass media falling away, as niche services, like the 3 blogs I've just mentioned, taking its place? Just think about that one carefully for a moment, because I would like to know your answer, as well as a few others as well.
Can I answer your question about where I get my news? So it might be a bit unsuspecting, since I've tweeted more than 170,000 times. I actually get a lot of my news from Snapchat now. A lot of the channels on there are really interesting. There's a Vox channel, which I think is mainly, I might be getting this wrong, mainly political. So I learned a lot about politics, especially American politics. And Mashable's Snapchat channel is really good too, finding constantly about the newest stuff. And also to add to the whole BuzzFeed thing, because I could see some people going, oh, no, don't mix that in journalism. I'm pretty sure they ran one of the first stories to ever interview one of the ISIS brides who running away with ISIS and that sort of thing. They actually tracked one down through Twitter, and I think it might have been a story about what our process was to get the story. So it's just like, you can't just instantly write it off just because they're doing listicles better than other places are. That's my view.
The other model for long form in the new media is Vice Media, which does a lot of long form television video documentaries, which actually pays for itself, again, using the sponsorship model to monetize what they're doing as opposed to display in time. And if anyone's looking for a future business model to support more journalism, the sorts of things that Vox, HuffPo to an extent, BuzzFeed, Vice Media are doing points in the direction for useful, real, good journalism that actually might have a future.
As an old hack, I rely on Radio New Zealand, RNZ. I'm just interested in what the panel thinks about what they're doing, not just Checkpoint and John Campbell, but I rely on them for the best journalism because I know that TVNZ, TV3, etc., the Herald, I used to work for them. You can't, for all these reasons, but that's the best source of proper news in New Zealand now, I think. I don't know what everybody else thinks.
I rely on it quite heavily to prep for my program in the morning. But I do, you know, there's a different perspective, and particularly Morning Report has it in reasonably thoroughly covered in reasonably short bites, which suits me as I prep for my day, which happens starts happening as soon as I open my eyes. That and Twitter, and clicking through links from Twitter tends to, unless I have to look further for something, tends to set me up reasonably well.
I have to confess, as a
former exact after this.
As a former journalist, when you drive into work before the Tuesday morning editorial meeting, you're like, shit, I haven't got an idea at all. What's the Morning Report? So all the way, you're like, oh, good, these are my news list for the day. I have to say, Radio New Zealand, and they need a lot of support because they do an amazing job. So we're kind of counting down, and I wanted to conclude this with a takeaway. And that takeaway is, what can we do? Are we happy with the way this is progressing? Is there anything, anyone, and I'd like some of the audience here, and I will have a sum up from the panel. There is clearly a big issue about democracy here because we do need an active, engaged media. They're only concerned about clickbait. They're only concerned about keeping their jobs. What can we do? Like, and the interaction between Twitter is kind of really interesting. Twitter needs to, people, Twitter users need to conduct themselves a bit better, but they play a very important role, and that is keeping the media honest. But going forward, in a country like New Zealand, we still have a lot of freedoms that are missing everywhere else, and it's really important, even compared to Australia. So what can we do? What can be the takeaway? How can we help promote a free, a very open and a very engaged media? So I'd like some response or tweets or anything from the audience about that, and then I'm going to get the panel to sum up, and then you can finish off the pizza and have some wine.
Anyone? I think one response is to become the media. I'm not a journalist, and I've been saying I'm not a journalist for about the last 15 years. In that time, I've been features editor of a couple of magazines, so I've become a magazine columnist, magazine features writer. I've got a radio show, I write columns for newspapers, but I'm not a journalist. And I'm able to do that stuff because I have the luxury of, I guess, time and not having to work as a journalist. That's actually a real luxury, not having that threat of losing a job, not having that threat of having to get that story done day after day after day. And some of the best content, some of the best journalism across all channels in this country at the moment, I think worldwide, is being done by people who don't rely on it for a living. I'm not saying that's the only solution, but I'm saying if you're sitting there going, gee, journalism's shit, radio's shit, blogs are shit, just become the media.
That was a sum up. She wanted a suggestion.
Yeah, I'm going to do a shout out to Kate Owen, who's right central. We're not saying they're only concerned about clickbait, and we're not saying they're only concerned about keeping their jobs. But what we are saying is we want journalists to be able to be journalists and not have that pressure. So I think it's really important. I, for one, feel that journalists today have an incredibly hard job. It's not easy. And there are some really, really good journalists out there. I think if we let them be journalists and take this pressure off them, that would be fantastic. What does everyone else think? So now I'm going to let the panel sum up. But just flick your thoughts through on the Twitter feed.
I think that's sadly unlikely to happen. And the most probably shocking example of this, in the last few days, you will have seen the last week or so, the Independent's closing down completely. It's a print.
No, it's only online.
No, I know that. It's just, but the print, the paper I'm talking about, the newspaper. And I started in newspapers, so that may not come as a shock to any of you, but I felt that like a blow. But I need to be perhaps more modern in my thinking, and hopefully the online content of The Independent and the other stable papers that goes along with that will produce some quality stuff and some long-form stuff. And despite the fact that you can no longer pick up that newspaper in your hands, which is a shame, but perhaps that's a really old-fashioned concept more and more, we won't necessarily be worse served, I suppose. Just differently served. So, and I think we have to, if we're going to be anything but dinosaurs, we have to start thinking like that. Fingers crossed.
I think people need to realise that the media that they've known for the last few decades will be gone within the next 10 to 20 years in the form they know, and that it needs to be replaced by something else. And that essential public subsidy, that public good produced by the immune system of democracy, which is the media, it will have to be paid in some other way, either by individuals, by subscriptions to newspapers or magazines or whatever it is. Secondly, by, frankly, the government, and we've heard about Radio New Zealand, which does a fantastic job, which funding should be increased from its 2008-2007 levels for a start. Thirdly, we also need New Zealand On Air, which currently provides, my understanding, more than $200 million a year in subsidies for various content, entertainments, music, all sorts of things. Some of that money should go towards subsidising news. Radio New Zealand is a good place to start with that. And also, I put out a challenge to all of you to say that how many of you actually pay for large numbers of subscriptions for your services? I pay for subscriptions to NBR, FT, Wall Street Journal, The Economist, New York Times. It costs me a lot of money. And I do it partly for my job, but I also do it for the journalism they produce, which keeps the bastards honest.
Can I ask how much you got Netflix subscriptions?
Yeah. So just to sum up for me, just to sum up how important this stuff is, at the beginning of last year, a city in the United States called Flint, Michigan. Anybody heard of Flint, Michigan? The government of Flint ran out of money. And so to save money, they decided to change their water supply from a lake to a toxic river, which they then pumped into the water system, which then corroded the pipes and exposed lead pipes. Over 600,000 kids were poisoned with lead. There were no reporters at the council meetings and the various meetings to actually report on this. And it took a year before the kids started getting sick. And eventually, citizen activists and some public radio media that were left in Flint, Michigan, actually started pressuring for change. It took a year and a half before they were exposed. And actually it only happened when the American Council of Civil Liberties employed an investigative journalist. So this is essentially a lobby group, employed an investigative journalist to go and report on it, and then to publicise it on national radio, essentially, the Radio New Zealand of Flint, Michigan. That was the only way it was covered. In the meanwhile, the immune system of democracy failed Flint. And just to give you an example, my understanding, there's only two or three reporters in Auckland who actually cover our council properly. It's almost as big as the central government in Wellington, just two or three reporters.
And I put the challenge out there to you. What are you doing to make sure that that public good keeps the democracy safe by being an immune system?
Something that I think I've kept going back to is something I agree with Vaughan, is that you become the media. Journalists, when they come out of uni, they're told you have to have a social media profile, you build that brand, you build that trust. She's a friend of mine, and I'm going to use her as an example, but Jess McCallan is doing amazing journalism thanks to the wireless, which you haven't seen anything like that in a long time. If you haven't, which I'm sure you all have because you use social media, seen the mental health series that Jess and the wireless put together, definitely check it out. Jess has worked since coming out of journalism school to build that brand, show that she is trustworthy with your information. And I think that's something that gets lost a lot of the time. One of the debates over the last couple of days was about a story on Stuff about, Mount Sider pulling an ad because it was offensive to the trans community. There was a quote used by someone and they published her entire name and they asked Stuff to remove it, and Stuff just was very staunch, didn't want to remove it. You're eroding your trust and confidence in the public, and they're not going to be giving you their information which helps you write their stories if you continue to do that. Whereas someone like Jess McCallan has proven over and over and time again that if you are a decent person and put your trust and confidence and fairness and balance first beyond anything else, look at the stories you can turn out. So I think at the end of the day, it's kind of funny, but journalists in a way have to be their own PR person. You have to be aware of how you come across in the public. And I think that's where a lot of pylons happen, because the media kind of insert themselves in, get very defensive about their stories, and don't realise these people are allowed to have a say too. So you've got to put yourself out there in the public, but you've kind of got to expect that people are going to have intellectual, intelligent debate with you about what you're reporting, because they feel that that matters. So.
Yeah, it's been playing up all night. Just answering your question I saw earlier, no, don't buy a Herald. I read it online with Ghostreading enabled, so I don't see their ads and they don't see my page impressions. It's a topic for another time. But I do buy things like Metro Magazine, because I do like Simon Wilson's work he does cover on Auckland issues. And I will subscribe to the NBR because I find that quality journalism that I can relate to. The question is, comes to being part of we, that is the citizen, being part of the media. I think I am doing my part through what I do through my Twitter account and blogging. As Bernard mentioned, Auckland Council is the second biggest public sector organisation in this country, yet there's only three reporters in Auckland that cover it, as well as three bloggers. I call that a democratic deficit in its own right. 1.5 million people, 34% of the country, 35% of GDP, and there's technically 9 people, maybe 10, that cover the issues that do matter to us, because they affect us day to day, right? Hands up if you were moaning about the traffic getting here. Hands up, who was moaning about the traffic? And it'll be everyone hands up on Friday when the buses go on strike and the trains break down. Now it's like Brimmer again. It affects us all, but there's that democratic deficit. What do we do about it? I'm not going to give that answer. I'm going to leave that to you, and I'm going to leave that to those who have followed us tonight. As I finish off, I do remember one slog that I did with Jess when she was a journalist before we joined council. It was the Auckland Development Committee, chaired by our wonderful Deputy Mayor, Penny Hobbs, and our councillors have a knack for going for a nice yarn. Jess and I sat through it for 9.5 hours, from 9 till beyond 6, with the councillors, recording everything down so that the next day we could report it out, so that you would know that this was what was going in your energy plan and, oh, your rates were going up. So, finally from me, do your part, try and avoid the pylons if possible, and more to the point, what do you want? Because if we don't know what you want, I might as well be writing pixels into oblivion, and that's not going to help anyone.
I think that was a very fine summation, and I'd like to thank everybody for coming along tonight. I think it's been a really interesting discussion. Please tweet anything, please put it up there, because I think this is a really important issue that we all need to engage in. And my advice would be just be engaged. You know, there's nothing wrong with having healthy discussion, but keep it polite, keep it kind, and keep it intelligent. So we have the usual, please clean up of yourselves, because we're all volunteers here, so just put all your stuff in the bins. We still have some alcohol in the bar, so please stay around to talk to the panel, talk to us, talk to each other. And thank you so much for coming on. It's really great to be back from Australia, where, to be honest, it's not so great. You don't have these discussions, and if you don't want it, you can lie. So it's wonderful to be back. Thank you.
Good night, everyone at home.